Okay, well, I'm going to talk about maternal psychological distress, and I'm doing this on behalf of the BIB Mental Health Working Group. And the outline of what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to talk about antenatal distress in the BIB cohort, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about the development and resolution of depression antenatally to postnatally in the BIB 1000 substudy. Now, what we aimed to do here was to see if we could look at mental health in this cohort, compare between ethnicities, and look at risk factors. So just from the literature, what are some of the risk factors for postnatal depression? Well, there are a variety of both antenatal and postnatal factors. So the presence of anxiety or depression during pregnancy, or a past history of psychiatric illness, things like stressful life events, lack of social support, marital problems, or less secure partnerships, such as a cohabitation or a not living with a partner. Obstetric factors have been shown in some studies causing a traumatic birth to be associated. Across nearly all studies, lower socioeconomic status has been associated with the postnatal depression. Not so clear in the literature is about younger maternal age or parity, and we do have less information on risk factors for UK-based South Asian populations. So just a bit about the measure and the population. We use the general health questionnaire as a measure of psychological distress that can be used in population studies such as this. It gives us four subscales: somatization, which is the physical embodiment of emotional distress, anxiety and insomnia, social dysfunction, and severe depression. And just for the time limits, I'm just going to focus on severe depression. The two samples from which we draw our data are the first 5,000 records in the BIB 1000 cohort, so the first 5,000 women who were recruited. I'm just going to talk about women who chose to complete their questionnaires in English only, and I'm just going to look at a bi-ethnic comparison. So we have just over 2,000 white British women and 1,500 Pakistani women. The other sample that I'm going to draw some data from is from the BIB 1000 cohort. Again, we're looking at English-only administration both times. We have a sample of about 460 white British and 350 Pakistani women in that sample. So some of you who were here last year may remember that we did present some data on prevalence of depression as measured by the GHQ. But at the time, we were rather unsure as to the differences that we were seeing between the ethnic groups were real or whether they were partially composed of some artifact due to different interpretations of the questions. So we spent our time looking quite rigorously at the psychometric properties of the GHQ-28. And we've used some techniques called confirmatory factor analysis, which helps us answer the question, are we measuring the same concepts throughout the ethnic groups? And we also used exploratory factor analysis, which we looked at the whole GHQ to look at how many concepts we were measuring. So just touch on this, I won't go too far into it. But what we aim to do is create a way of measuring mental health across the cohort. So we found that for this sample, the GHQ-20 actually seemed to be measuring five concepts. And that's because the concept of somatization actually split into two concepts. One was related to more general feelings, such as feeling ill. And then there was another concept related to some head, some questions about symptoms relating to the head. Now, some of the questions didn't appear to relate to the underlying things that we were trying to measure at all, and we dropped these questions. So in our aim to compare mental health across the cohort, we were able to do this and to get some sort of statistical confirmation that this was an okay thing to do. For the somatic general symptoms, social dysfunction, and severe depression subscales. So as I mentioned, I'm just going to focus on severe depression today. And just to run you through a couple of questions that are in the GHQ-28, a couple of examples. Over the last few weeks, have you felt that life is entirely hopeless, or have you felt that the idea of taking your own life kept coming into your mind? And there were four categories of response statements for this. The first category was not at all. And we call women that endorsed the not at all statement for these questions as having no symptoms. The GHQ-28 gives us a chance to look at chronic symptoms. So women who endorsed a statement that said, yes, I have these symptoms, but no more than usual. If they endorsed one or more of those statements without an endorsement of a more severe statement, we called those in a chronic situation. And then the two items on the right-hand side are, yes, I feel this rather more than usual or much more than usual. We categorize these women as having an acute status. So I'm going to use these terms as described. I think it's important to realize they don't imply diagnosis. And it's also quite possible that the women in the not at all category, because these questions ask about suicidality, may have dysthymia or low levels of distress. So 71% of the antenatal cohort had no symptoms at all, leaving 29 who did. And Pakistani women had more symptoms compared to the white British women. They were much less likely to have no symptoms. They were nearly twice as likely to endorse chronic symptoms and twice as likely to have acute symptoms. Because of these differences, we looked at some sociodemographic risk factors separately between the groups. We just used a few sociodemographic factors that we had available to us in the antenatal cohort. So these are adjusted. These are data from a multivariate adjusted analysis. And we find that actually there is an increased risk for women who were born in Pakistan and moved to the UK relatively recently, as found in many other studies, not managing financially, which was the answer to a self-reported question of their status. And although there were few women in this group, being a lone parent seemed to come out as a risk factor for this. Looking at the white British women, their risk factors, a similar picture, slightly different. Again, we've got the not managing financially. Younger age came out for this group as well, and any relationship state that was outside of a marriage was also a risk factor. So now I'm just going to touch on the development and resolution of severe depression, and for this it's the sub-study of the BIB 1000. So we did stick to English language only, and we needed completion of all the questions that we looked at. And this resulted in us using nearly all the sample of the white British and 74% of the sample for Pakistani, because the other 26 mostly chose to fill the questionnaire in a different questionnaire, in a different language. The postnatal question was given at 6 months. So for these 817 women, their categorization antenatally is shown on the left here. So 70% reported no symptoms, 22% reported at least one chronic symptom, and 8% at least one acute symptom. On the right-hand side is the postnatal status, and things look like they have improved postnatally. So we have 81% having no symptoms, 14% chronic, and 4% acute. So what we did is we traced what happened to each woman. And just breaking that down a little bit. So those with no symptoms, the vast majority of them continue to report no symptoms at 6 months. But we do have 11% of women who do start reporting symptoms postnatally. When we look at women who are in the chronic status antenatally, we can see that just under two-thirds go to report no symptoms. About 30% of them continue in this chronic state, and 6% go to acute. And when we look at those with acute symptoms, just over half don't report any symptoms, and the rest of them continue to report symptoms. So we then looked at the development of severe depression, and how we operationalized this was women who had no symptoms antenatally, then reporting some symptoms postnatally. And the overall prevalence of this was 11% in this sample. More Pakistani women than white British women did develop symptoms. When we looked at the risk factors separately for each group, we actually didn't find any for the Pakistani women, which I think is more reflective of the covariates that we were using, maybe are not of the biggest importance for risk factors. But in white British women, we did find that women who had more than one baby, that did seem to be a risk factor for the development of symptoms. And then we looked at resolution of depression. So women who had chronic or acute symptoms antenatally to no symptoms postnatally. And you can also think the flip side of this is a continuation of symptoms. We didn't find a difference in resolution between ethnic groups, a statistically significant difference. And we didn't find any risk factors for white women. But for Pakistani women, there's an increased risk of not recovering for those, again, who had a more recent migration and for those with less education. So just some strengths of our study. We are reasonably confident now that what we are comparing is valid between these two ethnic groups. And we have a large representative sample that enables us to do this exploration. It's just simply not possible to get to this level of detail with other cohorts. Just in terms of the data I presented today, it's important to realise that these labels do not infer diagnosis, and they're not a measure of prevalence. As I mentioned, we had few covariates, and they didn't explain a lot of the variants, so in the future, perhaps we'll be able to link more covariates that have some more relevance. Now, currently, there is no information on previous history of the fluctuation between the 27 weeks and the 6 months, and most critically, help-seeking diagnosis, treatments offered, and treatments uptaken by these women. And we're still trying to work on validating the GHQ that was given in the non-English languages. So we're hoping to develop a model that we can use across all women in the cohort. So just to summarise what I've talked about today, in our antenatal cohort, 29% endorse a question that indicates that they have severe symptoms. And Pakistani women are more likely to indicate severe depression than white British women. The risk factors that we found are what has been shown in the literature is lower financial and relationship stability. And now we have recent migration for Pakistani women, which we need to explore, and younger age for white British women. The longitudinal data, the 38% of women who were symptomatic antenatally are still symptomatic postnatally. And quite worryingly, 28% with acute symptoms lapse into a chronic status. So that's actually over 1 in 10 women developing symptoms between these two time points. Pakistani mothers are more likely to report development of symptoms. And we found that parity may be associated with depression. Now, we realise that not all children of parents with mental health problems develop problems. Actually, I'll just get on to the next slide there. So, our implications of policy and practice slide. Significant proportions of women experience continued or fluctuating psychological distress from pregnancy to motherhood. And this gives a high potential for disruption to the family functioning, the maternal morbidity, and most crucially, child development and behaviour. And this burden appears to be higher in the Pakistani community. But we think this highlights a need for continuing assessment throughout the pre- and postpartum periods so that these women can be picked up, diagnosed, and offered treatments. And I'd like to end by thanking the people who are laid on the front of the slide and also everyone who contributed to the cohort. Thank you.